Hi, I'm Mariah Inger.
And I'm Warona Setshwaelo.
And we are the coordinators of the Artist Mentorship Program, lovingly known as AMP, from Black Theatre Workshop.
We would like to start by dedicating the presentation you are about to see to the land that has been stolen and remains stolen. The art that we make here at the Artist Mentorship Program is in an effort to dismantle oppressive systems and return the land back to its original inhabitants. The original caretakers of this land are and continue to be the Ghanaian Gahaka, the Abenaki, the Anishinaabe, and the Huron-Wendat people. We stand with you. Aluta continua.
Thank you for that. So welcome. This is the Industry Showcase Season 2021 from AMP. We're very excited. It's the first time we are doing a full completed live streaming. Today you will see excerpts from a play titled Libation, written by our industry playwright this year, our mentee, Esi Callender. You will also see a scene from a play titled The Motherfucker in the Hat by Stephen Adley Gerges, and a multitude of different monologues written by different playwrights throughout the show today.
And a couple of songs.
We'd
also like to thank our sponsors and the people that supported us to make this happen. And that would be Canadian Heritage, the City of Montreal, the Dance School of Music and Drama, Geordie Theatre, and TD Canada.
We are so happy you have come to join us today. We are very excited. I know our mentees are extremely excited to present a show to you today. So thank you for taking out the time. After the show, we will be having a talk back. So there'll be plenty of time to ask some questions in our Facebook or our YouTube pages. So please stay tuned after that. Thank you so much. We appreciate it. Welcome to the show.
Bon spectacle.
Hi, I'm Esi Callender, and I wrote Libation, from which you're about to see some excerpts. Importantly, Libation is a play for an all-black cast. So for the synopsis, it begins in Act 1, where we meet Allie, a white girl and aspiring author who moves into a freshly gentrified neighborhood in a nameless North American city. Immediately inspired, she writes a novel telling the story of a black woman who lived there before her. The novel is published, and Allie is ascending. That is, until she meets Desdemona, a black woman who is losing her memory but swears that Ali has stolen her story, and the encounter between them destroys them both. Then, in Act 2, we meet Desi, a black PhD dropout, now barista, who is drunk in their bathtub after sending their newest play to an unresponsive mailing list. Mona arrives, demanding an explanation for the desperate script. "I get why you killed the white girl, but why did you kill yourself?" asks Mona, a black Ghanaian immigrant who came to get a degree, a Western passport, and the fuck out. The two rehash the commitment that their friendship requires, failed revenge plots and perfected essays, twists of adulthood, and visions for the future. Enjoy.
Daddy's hands. You are your dad. play. When he up and left me, I just up and run. Only thing in my head, you were your daddy's son. Couldn't hear no music. No light. Mama, she was frightened, crazy from the fright. Tears without no comfort, screams without no sound. Only darkness and pain, the anger and pain, the blood and the pain. I buried my heart in the ground.
Right? Like, for newly renoed, it's really still, you know.
Kept some of its older features.
I was gonna say a piece of shit. Possibly haunted. But you and your silver linings are so adorable.
I'm tired, Stephen. I am tired of saying that I'm sorry all the time. I am tired of tiptoeing through my life because it might interfere with yours. I am tired of being told what opera to like, what movie to go to, what book to read. I am tired of being your father, your mother, your big brother, your best friend, your analyst, your cheerleader. I haven't been your lover. since the first night I asked myself, who is this person? This stranger lying at my side, who hasn't heard me or held me since the last time it pleased him. God, that was the night that I should have grabbed you by the shoulders and screamed that I don't want this, Stephen. I don't need just another warm body next to mine. No, I am much too needy to settle for so little. Look at me. Love me. Be with me. No, now, I've waited too long. You would have been sleeping. You were reading. You had your friend on your cassette player on your side of the bed. Maria Callas. I had my arm around you. I was stroking one of your tits. And I asked you how you thought I should handle Sarah. She was coming up to New York and wanted to see me. And it was the first time since the divorce. And I was scared. I really needed you, Stephen. And you just shrugged. And you said, you'll do the right thing. And you turned the page. I didn't stop stroking your tit. But you weren't the same person anymore. And neither was I. I kept my arm around you only because I was suddenly so scared that I was as alone as I must have made Sarah feel. I was holding on for dear life.
We are all big fakes. Fake it till we make it, that's what we do. And that's what the universe does. Gives us what we want, even though we're only pretending to be ready. Give me that night in a van, in the parking lot. That perfect night under the stars, the way the first time's supposed to be. Feeling like something besides myself. Terrified. Excited. Lost and confused, just looking. Those brown Italian eyes. Finding comfort in knowing what I want, that this is what I want. Takes me over like natural urges. Fake my way right into it. Calm, straight in the eyes. Brave enough, strong enough, ready, unafraid, willing and wanting, fake prepared. Fake like I know what happens next. Fake like it's been done a million times before, and now it's no big deal. It's nothing at all. We both know we aren't supposed to, but we both feel it. Intensity. Unspoken energy, and for a moment we both become fire, a spark, both burning and growing, knowing while forgetting that this won't last forever, nothing this intense could last forever, the world would just explode. But for a moment it was ours. We didn't talk about it. Good. There's no room in that van for talk. There's no room in that star-filled sky for empty words and reason. Before he stopped the ignition to drive his both back. Back to that small town, in an even smaller world, he turns to me. He looks at me, he looks straight at me with those brown Italian eyes. He asks me with his calm, beautiful, confident and completely fake smile. Did it hurt? And I didn't know what else to say except, isn't it supposed to?
So, this book!
Yes!
What's it about?
Well, it's about a young woman living in the city, sort of on a journey of self-discovery. So she's lived away from her home country for the—
Did not mention you're living with an ethnic girl!
Uh-huh.
Have you gotten her permission to use her story?
No.
It counts, even if she was under the influence and gave you some sort of not of okay.
No, it's not about May.
Is it a genre novel?
It's a literary novel.
So you've got your young woman,
uh-huh.
your city,
mm-hmm.
you're coming of age, and—
Yes, and you know, it's this city. It's my neighborhood, even. And it's historical, sort of. She's this very self-possessed young woman, very critical, and yet very loving. And it's about how she navigated institutions and love and just trying to keep a roof over her head through these moments of profound change for the Black community.
Oh, Ali.
I know. I'm a white woman writing about a Black woman's story.
Your words.
Oh, God, Georgia. I thought about if it's, you know, problematic. I really think if you just read it, I really think I'm doing her justice. It does not speak for all Black women, just this one I could not get out of my head.
People can be so sensitive these days about representation.
Right? Like, they need more positive representation of complex Black characters.
But Ali, you'd have to answer this question time and time again. Why are you the right person to write this novel?
Maybe I'm wrong, but I'm an artist. This is what I'm trained to do. This is what I have to offer the world. I don't want to spend my entire life navel-gazing, always centering my own perspective and being afraid of— I'm an artist. Aren't I supposed to tell stories, important ones? I mean, who else is going to?
We're gonna read it, but I'll warn you, mm-hmm. Lady Parts Press is a very liberal publishing house. Mm-hmm. Mostly women, many feminists, but we are looking for coming of age and inspiring, and you know, this could be sort of an essential read to understand a young female's perspective amidst a civil rights movement taking over our streets.
Wow, and I could work with a Black editor and a Black book designer.
Yes.
And
yes, we would try, but there isn't always the interest, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
Look, if it doesn't pass the sniff test for us, but I find it a good read, I'll pass it to my brothers-in-law's press, the Devil's Advocate Publishing. Now, you heard of them? They still do blackface, so they can take a more sensationalist marketing strategy. Oh, trumping the edginess of it all.
And what if they don't want it?
Oh, you're a bright young woman. Someone will want it. And Linda, your mother has other contacts. How about I don't mention too much about the woman behind the book just for our first reads?
Mm-hmm.
Then we'll get a feelings of how my colleagues feels about it on its own. And if absolutely necessary, you can always become Black.
Pardon?
Only for as long as it's convenient. You could borrow someone's last name or use a pseudonym or have a great-great-granddaddy for a time.
I think I've heard of that.
Oh, I always advise young writers to give themselves a little bit of a wiggle room.
Are you
racially ambiguous?
Yes,
tragically.
You have no idea how proud of you we are.
We stand you no matter what.
Do we stand?
Yes, we stand.
Do we stand?
Yes, we stand.
I literally feel like it's all about to come crashing down on me.
Out with it.
We're here for you, sweetie. Georgia called saying that her assistant's been archiving all their manuscript submissions from the last, like, 10 years of open calls. And there's one of these random-ass manuscripts that she said sounded eerily similar to my bum!
What do you mean? Like someone plagiarized you?
Or like I think they think I plagiarized!
Oh, my God, baby.
Seriously, Francis? How could you even ask me that right now? Of course not!
We know you did it, baby.
I'm so fucking scared right now!
What can we do?
I don't know! I don't know what to do. Like, how many copies of this fucking manuscript is out there? Who is this fucking person!
That's a good question. Who are they?
Georgia gave me her name. Desdemona.
Is that a joke?
Maybe it's a pen name.
For a tragic mulatto.
I don't think you should, like, say that word.
It's the actual literary term for that trope. Are you, like, offended?
I don't think you meant anything by it, Francis, but
guys! Focus.
Yeah. He's my brother. We ain't close. Ain't like we grew up together or nothing. Ain't like I'm going around his house every Christmas singing Silent Night. Shit, I didn't even know the fucker existed till I was like 14. I'm coming out of school one day, right? And I see this immigrant kid waiting there. He's looking at me, see? But I don't think nothing of it. People are often looking at me, you know? I got striking features or something. Anyway, after that, everywhere I go, I see a man, this immigrant kid. He's like my fucking shadow, my little immigrant shadow. I walk, he walks. I stop, he stops. Eventually, I just stop and fucking stare at him, see, like this. And I'm like, okay, shorty, spill. He's got this posh little voice, man. And he's like, I know you. You're Nigel, aren't you? I'm like, yeah, I know who the fuck I am. Who the fuck are you? He's like, my name's Karim. I think we might be related. I'm like, yeah? He's like, yeah, I think you're my brother, Nigel. I'm like, go away, kid. I ain't got no brother. But he just stands there, right? This sweet little kid. And then he go, listen to this. Then he go, neither do I, but I think you might be him. Neither do I, but I think you might be him. He must have heard his uncles talking, see? Laughing about his old man going on and on about Papa's little white boy. That's what they call him, Papa. Like he's the big daddy or something. Like he's got baby mamas all around shop. Like he's some kind of Mac. He's a smart kid. Anyway, I'm like, fuck off, kid. I ain't your brother. I ain't no immigrant, am I? But then I tell my mother, and I know from her face, man. I know from her silence. I know from those little tart eyes. That kid telling the truth. It's like when I was little, and I'd be going to school, and people would be shouting, immigrant, 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 hey, immigrant, immigrant, and I'm looking around, but I don't see no immigrant. They're shouting at me, see? And I'm like, I'm fucking Canadian, man, I ain't no immigrant. It was right. It was right. They knew me better than I knew myself. Immigrant. Nigel the immigrant.
I don't give a fuck about your fight. Fuck your progress. This is your progress, nigga. Me. Here, I'm your fucking progress. This is what you achieved. Shit. Deal with that, nigga. Deal with the sacrificial fucking lamb to your better world. And what is better, huh? What the fuck did you achieve? My mama died with a broken heart waiting on your progress. You were the motherfucker who wouldn't throw her a damn bone. You want these letters so bad? Why'd you never write her? I'm not talking about them scrap pages of your ideas and meditations when you were locked up and getting your brain swollen with information on politics and philosophies and whatever. I'm not talking about that intellectual masturbation on a fucking piece of prison paper. I'm talking reciprocity. I'm talking speaking from the core of your goddamn heart instead of sounding like a fucking activist robot. I know her better than you ever will. I listen to her pine over your worthless ass. I listen to her talk about what she thought made you such a goddamn hero. How you stood up for niggas getting railroaded by the justice system. How you stood up for anybody being brutalized by the cops. How you protested corporations helping to fund apartheid. How you did all this shit for the whole goddamn free world. But when she told you she loved you, what'd you do, huh? When she told you she wanted you to settle the fuck down and be with her, what'd you do, huh? You stand up for that shit?
I mean, maybe my book's about nothing if it's never been read.
No one's ever read it?
Well, my friends have. Good friends, too, who will read you and tell you what they really think and mark up your pages and talk about you like you put something into the world even though it's only held together by strings.
I miss the pages.
Yeah, it didn't look professional, but after all the notes, I wrote up a second draft and it didn't look half bad. It read well. I sent it round to a few places, but I figured to get a book published in this country, especially as a black girl, you have to at least know someone who knows someone.
Then why would they have open calls?
To keep the myth of meritocracy alive? To justify capitalism?
You know, I also struggle with the question of what is your work about? Because I really think about why I write, which is really to connect to people, especially women, despite our differences.
What do you mean by that?
What do you mean? What?
Like, what differences?
Like, for instance, telling more stories of marginalized women so that others can understand them.
They can't tell their own stories.
I think it's the responsibility of the artist to tell all stories that are vitally needed in our society.
That sounds real nice. Maybe I'm just paranoid after all these years, but I'm always a bit on edge when someone gets their rhetoric to sound so perfect like that.
I'm far from perfect.
Desdemona, I have something for you. Oh, what are you doing?
Don't judge a book by its cover, right? I want to see what you got here. The body of a woman I love.
What the fuck?
Look! Every word matches. Can I?
Get away from me!
No, no, I'm trying to show you that they're all the same words. These are all the same words. These are my words. And this is my life and in words and question marks.
This book is my whole life right now. You're not gonna take that away from me.
How can it be your whole life when it's got my whole life in it?
Let me show you.
This is the only copy I've got. I can't fight you.
Please don't hurt me.
I can't. You know, every time someone like you moves into a neighborhood like this, you are sentencing someone else to an unthinkable fate. But not even your kind will forgive what you're doing right now.
What else can I do?
Thank you.
you have to do it yourself. I left the seminary because I needed to learn how to help people, really help people, heal people, cheat, cheat death. When I saw my first bird, that's 2D, I mean, I've seen the films. When I saw life come into being, into the room, when I cut the miraculous fruit of life with my own two hands, I knew that's what I wanted to do, to bring life, to bring as many life into the world and catch as many new souls. That is cheating death. Doesn't make sense, but that's what I thought. Meningitis. Meningitis. If I couldn't catch meningitis in my only child to save her, save me. You know how much I wanted babies, our babies. And we kept losing. I kept losing. And then Janie, she stayed. She grew. She would hold me so tight around my waist sometimes, like she was trying to get back inside of me. Like I was her fingers and toes, and she'd miss having them around all days. Like I was her everything. And she was mine. And I am still there, Michael. I am always there. She's sitting on the toilet. I'm on my knees, holding her hands, and then she falls on my breast. And I think she's playing. She must be playing. But she won't wake up, Michael. And she's in my arm. I'm calling 911, and I am trying to get her back, and then it stops. Her heart stops. Everything stops. And I get it started again. Oh, it's okay. It's okay. She's gonna be all right. And I'm running. I start running because it comes to me. If I run fast enough, faster than time, time will slow down and go backward, and I'm running, but I can't run fast enough, Michael. I can't run fast enough.
Your black death. In fact, you only speak to it through the white girl's rambling guilty conscience, and then you write her this metaphysical esoteric death.
It's my artistic license.
Oh, is it also your cry for help?
Oh no, is that why you're here? You left the party for that? I thought you came here to toast me and say, congratulations, stellar play, Desi, you really knocked my socks off.
I am not, that is surely not something I would come here to say. You were supposed to meet me there, then you are not answering my texts or
I'm so sorry. I don't mean to make you worry about me. I never want to make you feel that way.
Well then, don't take drunken and whatever else bubble baths like you are Whitney Houston.
May she rest in power! You watched the documentary I sent you!
I told you I will engage with the North American minutiae you sent me on the condition that it is about black culture. It is the only thing worth reclaiming from this continent.
That's... A lot of people would find that very offensive, Mona. There's like other thriving arts here. And you're kind of throwing the indigenous culture babies out with the colonial...
Yay! For real, I can go! I'm here for you!
No, don't go! Stay! We deserve a small
I day. Will stay. I will have a drink in here even, on the condition that you sacrifice one of your pillows to make that toilet a proper seat. Abraham, an icicle before my very eyes.
Mm-hmm.
for the homies? Look, Desi. You are doing it again. What? This time in the form of plays.
Theater is the worst medium. I know.
It is better than your performance art phase.
Do you remember the time when I dressed up in that nude bodysuit? But not like me nude, like white person nude. And then just tried to crack open this entire watermelon open with my bare hands. And then ate it in its entirety, even the shell with my bare mouth. And how did that get into such a serious gallery?
Desi, you are making people deal with your emotions, with your constipated emotions.
I think the word you're looking for is repressed.
Ah, emotions are so guttural, see? You are making me deal with it with each new fever dream play that you send me. It is the same reason why I told you we cannot be friends if you kept setting all these white people.
And I heard you, because you were so right. And I broke up with Madison and moved out of that toxic queer cooperative living space. And I even set boundaries with my mom, man. With my mom.
And I am proud of you. You have made a lot of progress. But you know I cannot take any responsibility for that, right? That is all, those were your choices.
Yo, yes, I know. It's just, you're such a real friend. Mm. You tell shit to me straight out. Fucking hold me to account. I love that. I hope I do that for you.
You do? You have a certain... No, you have been a very committed and loyal friend. But when we get to these points, when you are putting so much energy into white people, whether it is taking care of them, or navigating their spaces, or writing plays about them...
The plays are an outlet!
When you are doing all that, Desi, what do I have left for your black community? What do you have left for me, huh? What do you have left for you?
Community is a tricky topic. Coercive, even.
I know, we can get back to that. But do you understand what I mean?
Yes, I understand. But what can you do? They're everywhere.
Well, I am going back to Africa.
Mona.
What? I can say that. This is literally where I'm from. I'm going back. I lived in Accra up until just 5 years ago.
No, I mean, Mona, I'm gonna miss you.
Well, then maybe you should become the kind of friend who can run away with me. Or who can go on their own adventures and find more true friends so you will not be so heartsick missing me.
Maybe. But man cannot change his nature. Mm.
Good thing you are something much stranger than a man. No, but I did appreciate your little shout out to me in the play. Comparative literature. When I got the letter of rejection claiming that I could not be admitted, despite my qualifications, because there was no one in the department familiar with any West African languages to supervise me.
A self-fulfilling prophecy.
That was the worst night of my life. This country started to feel inescapable again. I thought I would drown in her shallow pool of mediocrity and immigrants' tears.
And white kids' piss.
And that was the worst night of my life, but you did not let me be alone.
Count on me, your local college dropout, to talk shit about academia with you any day.
You made me eat, and you made sure I did not lose my brain for good.
Hey, now, I can't take all the credit for that. You've made a lot of progress.
Take some credit, because that is why I am here, to answer your cry for help.
Boy, you sure do like reciprocity, huh? Can I go down on you?
No.
I was just joking.
I know, just to be clear.
You know, it's your fault, really.
What, Desi? I've not done anything. You don't have to victim blame.
No, I mean the plays are your fault. You introduced me to the idea of narrative revenge.
Only as a sort of good plotline for a beginner writer to create a relatable main character with justified motives. That white girl was far from sympathetic. You did not achieve that at all.
Okay, but remember the time when you almost punched that white lady you lived with?
Yeah, she had pushed me to the edge, oh. To the point where I actually wanted to use physical force, something I had never felt until I moved to this bullshit country.
And she could have called the cops, right?
Certainly, she was thinking of such. When I raised my voice, something I wasn't even aware of as this violence that yelling is considered to be in this cultural wasteland where civility is used as a substitute for humanity, not just substituted, but weaponized against all those who do not adhere to the most strict social codes of conduct, which delineates things such as how quickly you must speak, how
to another person, when and if you may laugh, when and if you may disagree, and God forbid you speak louder than the passive-aggressive whisper. Ah, Desi, I know too many horror stories of this. This is why I do not like to talk about such things.
Oops, sorry.
She had pushed me to the edge. If I had hit her, I would have been deported, no question.
So what did you do instead?
Close my mouth.
Wearing next to none, you know what I'm saying? Because why should I be mad? At least he said goodbye this time. I just wish I hadn't wasted my money buying this stupid present. Hey, man. You ain't gotta do nothing, man. Ain't like I'm still 5 years old, right? Ain't like I'm gonna be sitting around every night asking my mom, when's dad coming home, right? Yo, who needs him? Hey, he wasn't there to teach me how to shoot my first basket, but I learned, didn't I? And I got pretty damn good at it, didn't I? I went on my first date without him. I learned to shave, I learned to drive, I learned to fight without him. I had 14 great birthdays without him. He never even sent me a damn card. Yo, to hell with him. I ain't need him then and I don't need him now. You know what? I'm gonna get through college without him. I'm gonna get a great job without him. I'm gonna marry me a beautiful honey and I'm gonna have me a whole bunch of kids. I'm gonna be a better dad than he's ever been. And I sure as hell don't need him for that. Because ain't a damn thing he can ever teach me about how to love my kids. How come you don't want me, man?
Excuse me, I am not waiting in that line for another 2 hours. I demand to speak to your supervisor. Oh, you're the supervisor. Well, can I say that this whole thing is not being handled professionally? You're rude, and you treat people like cattle. You don't know what circumstances brought each of us here today. We've waited all day to get to this point. We just want to sit in a room and talk to somebody. Anybody? I mean, isn't there anyone in all this miserable bureaucracy who isn't merely concerned with what time to take their lunch? We need help. We are entitled to this benefit. We have all humbled ourselves just by being here, and you're behaving like some centurion guarding the gates to Rome. I mean, who gave you the right to condescend? Give me the motherfucking form! I'm not leaving without the form! Give us the form! We want the form! Come on, people! Give us the form! We want the form! We can come back tomorrow and start this whole damn process again. But who wins?
And I am medically removed from the building, which means the paramedics arrive, administer a mild sedative, strap me to a gurney, and rush me to the nearest psychiatric facility, where I spend half an hour speaking to a gentle intern, who incidentally went to college with my assistant Steffi, and I'm subsequently released with a powerful antipsychotic I can't use because I am pregnant. And after all that, I still must go back to that office to fill out Form 7001. And after weeks of agony and bureaucratic hell, I was finally able to see a doctor.
Annie! Anyway, I told Jackie I would be accompanying him here today so he doesn't try to pull the wool over your eyes.
Well, glad to have you. How's the empanada?
Fucking delicious. Jackie, why don't you tell Julio here about your present predicament?
I need you to hide this gun from me, man.
Start at the beginning, Jackie.
Nah, I don't think I want to hear this.
No, wait, Julio. Events transpired.
Be specific.
Okay, there was a small incident.
From the beginning, Jackie.
All right. A couple months ago, back when I first got out, Ralph and I here had a fight.
We had a disagreement,
and he fired me as his sponsee.
You fired yourself.
Okay, for the sake of fucking brevity, I fired myself. And then I needed a new sponsor, so I... Wait, you know what a sponsor is, right?
I was in the Sex Addictions Fellowship, so yeah, I know.
Sex Addiction?
It's all behind me now.
No pun intended. Anyway, I needed a new sponsor, huh? So I got this woman, which, you know, everybody said, don't get a girl as a sponsor for a guy, but I was in a pinch.
You were attracted to her.
She had a very strong program.
Strong set of C-cups, Julio. Fucking Betty Boop with a big book, believe me.
I see.
Anyway, nothing happened, but Veronica fucking hated her. Threatened to, quote, rip the bitch's vagina from out her fucking mouth, so I had to lie and say that we weren't working together no more. And the lying led to doing things on the DL, and the DL led to feeling like there was something going on, and, you know, feeling like there was something going on.
You fucked her.
I didn't fuck her. She fucked me.
Yeah, you know how that goes, Julio. Women overpower men by sheer physical force and pin them down and ride them like ponies all the fucking time. It's in the papers every day.
Okay, whatever. Something fucking minuscule happened, and I immediately ended it, and I apologized to Ralph, who took me back, but then this crazy AA girl started calling the house, and even though she never said nothing like we fucked, like on tape, Veronica got it in her head that we had, even though, for all she knew, we hadn't.
But you did.
Okay, but she didn't know that, and really, it was more like a dream. And no, not like a dream that I, like, aspired to, huh, but like a fucking nightmare. Well, you wake up and you're all fucked up and you're just like, did that just fucking happen? You know, but unfortunately, in this completely unintended instance...
It did?
Yeah, technically.
You fucked her.
Okay, technically, and that's my cross, but in reality, Julio, in the fucking dimension outside of temporary insanity, in my heart, you gotta believe me, that shit never happened.
Okay, so except for the fact that it actually happened, it didn't really happen.
Exactly!
It's good to see we're all on the same page here.
Yeah, man, I get it. I do. It happened to me once with a guy named Frank. It was way before I got married to Morris.
No, and we don't care about that right now, okay? Anyway, because of this crazy eagle, which, look, I had a part in it. I'm not trying to make it like I'm a saint, even though I'm straight up more or less not guilty. But the point is this. You know the motherfucker with the hat who lives downstairs from me?
A man with a hat.
Oh, you know him? You've seen him? He's all like, fake dapper, and his pants got creases and shit, and he's always wearing a white t-shirt that he throws out after one fucking day. You know that thinking he's a GQ motherfucker? And he's always sporting a brim to cover his big fucking head?
I don't know.
Anyway,
Veronica, I think, was upset about the AA woman, so my belief is that she started fucking that motherfucker with the hat so she could prove to herself that she don't love me, but of course we know that she do love me, and now I found out about it because that motherfucker left his hat on my table, so I got upset, I got a gun from Chuchi, and I took the gun and the hat to the motherfucker with the hat's apartment downstairs, and that's when a small incident happened.
You didn't shoot him, did you?
No, see, that's what Veronica would have done. She would have knocked on the door and started capping bodies and shit, but that ain't me. Julio, you know me since Chinese handball, is that me?
It's not him, it's really not.
All I did, I knocked on the door. The motherfucker with the hat answered. I didn't say nothing. I just took the hat from my house, huh? And I tossed it on the carpet. I looked him straight in the eye, I cocked the gun, and I shot the hat on the carpet, that's all.
You opened fire in his residence?
I shot the hat on the carpet, that's all I did. And believe me, that motherfucker knew what that was about, huh? But the problem was that the bullet, it went through the hat and then ricocheted off the floor and it blew out his big screen TV and then put a hole in the guy next door's apartment who was home at the time. So I had to, like, flee. And now I gotta return the gun to Chuchi, but he ain't around. So could you please hide the gun for me, man, until, like, Chuchi could be located, please?
You borrowed a gun from Chuchi.
I know.
Chuchi!
Look, I wasn't thinking right.
You borrowed a gun from Chuchi Alvarado. You did bad things with it, and now you want me to hide a gun of Chuchi Alvarado.
I understand if you say no.
Can I be honest with you?
Come on, man, please!
No, Jackie. It's okay, I'll hide the gun.
Oh, thank you.
All I want to say to you is that I'm happy to help because you're my cousin, you're my blood, but really, I'm doing it more for your mother's memory than for you, and I'd like to tell you why.
Yeah, okay, whatever.
Julio, would you like some privacy for this? I could wait in the kitchen or outside on the stoop.
No. Thanks, though. And if you ever need a massage or some waxing, I'll give you my card.
Thanks.
Roughing is my specialty in Brazilian.
Cool.
I'm also a notary public.
I'm in nutritional beverages. I'll give you my card.
Great. Give me some more to pass out. I'm all about networking.
Me too.
Bless you.
Yo! Y'all got any more cards you need passing out? Or can you tell me what you want to tell me, Julio, so I can be on my way?
Oh, sorry. I didn't know you were in a rush. You got what you want and leave.
Hey, I'm not.
Yeah. You are. And that's okay. The reason why I say I'm doing this more for your mother's memory than for you is because, maybe I've never said this before, but I don't like you very much. And the reason why I don't like you very much is because you think you're a nice guy, but really, Jackie, you're not that nice. You basically made fun of me my whole life. You talk a lot of shit, you fuck people over, not all the time, but sometimes. And really, Jackie, the space between who you think you are and who you actually are is an embarrassingly wide gap. I really hope this AA thing works out for you. I really do, because the cousin I loved and hung out with and played booties up with when I was 8 bears no resemblance to this little shit I'm looking at right now. When I first came to the state, you had my back. And really, you were a hero to me. And now, hero is zero. My mother's always right about you. It's always all about Jackie. We've been married for 3 years now, and whenever you come by your home, you don't even bring so much as a bag of pistachio. And yet you see nothing wrong with jeopardizing my relationship, my apartment, and our home by bringing criminal things like that shit into our house. You're not a good friend. You're not a good relative. My relationship to you is that of a memory that ceased to be any kind of reality years ago. My mother so called it. You're a user, but that's okay. That's all I have to say on that. So now you can get out of my apartment and go do those very more important things than spending time with your cousin Julio, okay?
No,
go. Leave the gun, take the empanada.
But you'll have this place to call home. silence of the ears, darkness of the mind. This love will keep us through blinding of the eyes. Silence of the ears, darkness of the mind. This love will keep us through blinding of the eyes. Silence of the ears, darkness of the mind. This love will keep us through blinding of the eyes. Silence of the ears, darkness of the mind.
And I finally got to see them in real life. Great.
Same question, Zui.
It's obvious, makes the world difference going from Zoom on a computer to here. It's, you know, realize how tall people really are.
how short they really are.
And yeah, just the human connection is so important in, you know, acting, and you can't replace it.
Same question, Charity.
Okay, hi, Charity here. So it was really crazy to finally meet everyone in person, mostly because of the fact that, yeah, we had seen each other in little boxes for 8 months, but it was really great to finally meet everyone, and it honestly just felt like almost time didn't pass. Like, it just felt like we always met up, and then when we finally met, it was just like, you know, a great group connection.
Yeah.
Thank you. Next question is for Esi, our playwright. Why did you want to explore the subject matter in this way?
I'm not sure which part of the way is being asked about, but why I wanted to explore the subject matter in this way, I guess, was trying to create I guess like a work that would have some kind of distance between who the performers were and who the identities being represented are, and then would also have the opportunity to explore Black characters who are also played by Black people, kind of having this duality. And I was also kind of excited to be able to create this sort of like challenging structure, like a structure that has multiple parts that work kind of like with or against each other. Yeah, I don't know if that answers that. Thank you.
Thank you. Next question. What inspired you to choose your individual pieces? Let's start with Anaïs.
Oh, Anaïs here. I have a connection. When I read, I read a few monologues here and there, and it really, I just kind of let my gut decide for me, basically. It's like, what do I feel when I read this monologue? What do I feel, really? It's not even about, can I do it, can I not? It's like, do I feel a connection? Where is the humanity? Where is the, can I relate? And things like that. So it's really like my gut, for some reason, kind of always decides all those things for me. And I just, as I start working on it, it just cements like the reason why I chose it. So yeah, it's about how I feel.
Same question for you, Aaron.
Hi. So I chose the monologue I did. I'm usually very picky with these. Like, I go through so many and then they just don't click. This one I think clicked for a few reasons. One, I think it's just beautifully written. But also definitely I think one of the things that I know about myself as a performer is, and I've been told, is that my performances tend to be kind of like clean, as it were, like not, you know, very planned and that kind of thing. And I want to try to break out of that box. And so this monologue is very emotional and it's very messy and you just like dive right into all of that. It also is a queer monologue, which was very important to me. It's something that I've wanted to do for a while. So yeah, that's why I picked it.
Same question for you, Johnny.
Hi, Johnny. So I picked my monologue because I found a strong connection with it. It explores a character who's finding his identity. And I relate to that as an artist, being mixed race racially. So I just found a strong connection to that. Yeah.
Awesome. So I have a question from Christine Lee. I think this will actually fit for Chadia and Joy. We'll start with you, Chadia, because the question is, curious about the music. Would love to hear some thoughts about it during the talkback. So Chadia, I think you should explain what you did.
Hello, my name is Chadia. the music. So my piece, the song that I picked was Godspeed by Frank Ocean. And what I wanted to do was I wanted to take the song and kind of create it into kind of my own sound and what I envisioned myself singing. And I got to work with these amazing producers, Jamal and Thane, shout out. And we worked together where I kind of just talked about why I picked the song, and I picked it because it's more of kind of saying goodbye, kind of on a journey. I've been through a lot, we've all been through a lot during this pandemic, and I just feel very different than I was almost 2 years ago. And the director, Mike Payette, really enjoyed it, and he decided to take the background music from my song and connect it with the play as interludes. So yeah.
Fantastic. Joy, do you have anything to say?
Hi, Joy. So music. Well, my song is Your Daddy's Son from Ragtime, and the first time I ever heard that song, it stuck with me. Something about it just, the emotion, the rawness of it just lingered with me. And when I was picking a song for the show, I wanted something with that quality. And it just, it was the right fit. It was it. And I had been working on this song for a few years. I had done it for Kiwanis so a while ago. And so it was something that I was familiar with. And it just fit for me. I don't know how else to explain. There are no right or wrong answers. That's my final answer.
I have another question for everybody. What was it like to perform live but with no audience? Is it? Zooey, why don't you start?
The funny thing is, we've been performing it for Mike, for the director and everybody, and then we only moved to camera this week. And then suddenly I realized that, oh, wait a minute, I'm talking to a camera. Nobody's gonna be like, yeah, good job. So it takes a little bit of time to adjust. It's not as fun, personally, not having an audience. I miss that so much, but you know, we gotta do what we gotta do. Send a message out there.
Same question to Dre.
I would say, yeah, I kind of feel what Zooey's saying, you know, like, by the way, Dre over here. I found the transition pretty interesting because when you're performing on stage, you can feel the energy from the crowd that just drives you through and keeps you going. And you get off stage when your scene is done, and you're like, yeah, yo, it's up to the end. And all right, with this, it's kind of like you said, speaking to a camera. That's just it. It's like, okay, so I'm speaking to this little thing here, and hopefully, hey, man, like, I hope they're receiving this well, you know? But yeah, it's interesting. It's an interesting transition.
Espoir?
Yeah.
Same question.
What was the question again?
Well, what is it like performing live?
Performing live without an audience. You know what? I really think about this, and I don't even need to sound like, woo,
But like, we can feel the community here, and we can feel, there's been little messages, little emails, little whatever, there's been Facebook posts and Instagram posts, and like, I think this whole week has been about that, knowing that it's coming to a big sharing, and knowing that it's coming to the end of a process for us. We've been together for 8 months, and so just like knowing that it's over and we're letting in people in to see what we've been brewing up, it's like, yeah, there's no audience, but it's like, what, why would we put in, why would we do all this if not for sharing, if not for everyone? So I feel everyone, I really do.
Well said. One last question, Esi, I want to ask you, what's it like watching your work live, but not live, with Zoom in Vancouver?
Yeah, I think I can really echo what Espoir was saying. Like, I feel like even though I'm not there, I can feel the energy, a lot of what is going on there, and of like how it what's like radiating off of the performers and everything. And I'm definitely like watching my own work. It's always a challenging thing, and so exciting, but so hard. And so I'm like holding my breath with like every line and stuff. Also, not even in the scenes that are not mine, just because like I care about what they're doing a lot. So in the scenes that other people wrote to me, I'm like, okay, oh wow, they did it. And I think it's like a, I don't know. I feel a lot like I'm there in some ways. And it's kind of nice too, because it gives a little bit of space too to like learn from what I'm seeing without having the same super intense level of emotional investment that you have when you're watching your work sitting next to a bunch of people who are also taking it in and rolling along with like every chuckle or sigh or other maybe like expression that comes out of people. So there's something kind of nice about that. But I do miss them. I wish I was there in a long way. It's really beautiful to see them all like this, and I feel so like taken care of to have people take up my scenes even without me and run with them and make them something special.
Aww. Well, that's it for the talk back. I adore all of you. We're so proud. Thank you everyone for watching us.
Thank you.
Thank you.